So our last speaker is Gianfranco De Zotti, who's going to talk to us about synergies between Planck and Herschel on extragalactic point sources.
We have the laser at the center, and we can switch between.
Okay.
Thank you. So tomorrow and on Friday we will hear some new results on Herschel observations of sources detected by Planck, and I will not enter into these new results. I will only discuss some issues related to the general framework for interpreting the synergies between Planck and Herschel. Now, there is a very obvious complementarity between Planck and Herschel in that Planck has provided all sky surveys, but down to relatively shallow flux density limits, while of course Herschel has gone much deeper and has, however, unlimited ranges of the sky. And as illustrated by this representation of the counts, you can see that Planck has actually extended by two orders of magnitude the flux density range over which the counts are now defined, so easily, complementing the counts from Herschel. These sources turned out to be very local ones, within about 100 megaparsecs, and as such, they constituted a very rich and interesting sample to study the local properties of galaxies, and we, for example, local luminosity function and general population properties of local star-forming galaxies, and we will hear about that tomorrow from Mattia Negrellos and Marcel Clemens talks. Another thing that Planck can do, thanks to its full sky coverage, is the detection also of some extreme aggressive sources that will present very special properties, and on which I will make some brief comments in the following. Herschel in turn has provided key information about the high redshift evolution of star-forming galaxies, and in particular the Herschel observations in fields that have extensive coverage at many frequencies has allowed to determine quite a few spectroscopic redshift and also reliable photometric redshifts, and this has allowed to determine the evolution of the sublimiter luminosity function over redshift range up to about 4. Now, an interesting property of this luminosity function that was pointed out by Lappi et al. Is that it seems to reflect quite nicely the halo production rate as a function of redshift. This is illustrated here by these dashed lines, which are what we call a toy model. This toy model consists simply in taking the halo production rate given by the standard lambda CDM model and translate it into a luminosity function. And this requires simply knowing how long the star formation phase continues. And what it is found is that a good match is obtained for a star formation phase lasting about 0.7 giga year. This is an interesting number because it is also the same duration that allows us to account very easily for the observed alpha enhancement in the massive spheroidal galaxies. If we enter into this kind of scenario, so we consider what we call a self-regulated galaxy evolution model in which the halo formation proceeds through a fast merging phase in which the potential well of the galaxy is built and followed by an evolution that starts from this phase with a very strong star formation rate, but then proceeds essentially controlled only by internal baryon processes. This gives this introduces also processes like feedback from supernovae and active active nuclei, and we end up with a model represented here by the solid line, which in fact does not differ very much from the toy model. It mostly differs from the fact that this duration is not found to be constant, but depends to some extent on the halo mass. Now, if we take into account that the sublimiter luminosity, or in general the infrared luminosity, is a measure of this transformation rate, we can, from this association between the halo mass function and the luminosity function, infer a relationship between the star formation rate and the halo mass. And this is the relation that comes out. So in direct proportionality, roughly. In fact, if we take into account the full model, there is a slight different exponent here, which is slightly different from unity. But to a first approximation, this is good enough. And this is telling us, if we look again to the luminosity function, and we look at which are the luminosity and then the star formation rates that correspond to the knee in the luminosity function, so to the population of galaxies that contribute most to the cosmic star formation rate, we find that these objects have star formation rate of the order of a few hundred solar masses per year. And using this formula, then we obtain that the associated halo masses in this framework should be of the order of 2 to 4 × 10^12 solar masses. Now, this is a property which is a bit distinctive of this kind of approach. It's the result that we would have obtained if we have considered alternative models, for example, cold flow models, would be different. In this case, for cold flow models, the halo masses implied are, would be substantially higher than this, while if we consider the merger plasto-heavy initial mass function model, we would have obtained substantially lower halo masses, as discussed in these references. Now, this makes us possible for us to make a comparative test of the predictions of these models by taking into account that the power spectrum of the intensity fluctuation of this cosmic infrared background has an amplitude which is sensitive to the effective halo masses. And this is because, we know, we have this bias factor coming in, and this bias factor is a steep spectrum of the effective halo mass for the high masses we are considering here. Now, there is also some dependence on the models through this cumulative flux function, which depends on the redshift evolution of the luminosity function. However, the dependence is very strongly constrained by the data. I've just shown before there are data on luminosity function at several frequencies. We have additional constraints coming from redshift distributions for several flux density limited, again at several wavelengths. And further constraints come from counts per redshift beam. And so this means that if we require that a model that we use to compute the power spectrum fits all this data, as the case for this model, then in fact the dependence, the model dependence turns out to be quite limited. Now, what that, do we get if we fit, we try to fit, if we try to fit the power spectrum? Well, we get a fit with, in effect, a minimum halo mass of about 1.4 × 10^12 solar masses, and an effective halo mass at redshift of 2 of about 4.5 × 10^12 solar masses, which is close to the estimates that we got for from the completely independent approach discussed above. I mentioned the potential of Planck for detecting extreme sources. And now we already heard from Joaquin Vieira that we now have some counts of strongly lensed sources at millimeter wavelengths and also on the redshift distribution. Joaquin has pointed out to us that, in fact, the observed redshift distribution shown here is pretty challenging to fit by various models, but it's quite nicely reproduced by the model I've been just describing. The point here is that if we remember what Joaquin González Nuevo has just told us about the 90% completeness limits for Planck, we see that the expectation based on the model that fits this data is that we are at flux density that Planck can really detect. Now, so far, the only published detection of a strongly lensed galaxy which has a counterpart in the Planck Early Least Compact Source Catalog is this one by Herranz et al. This, however, the flux density of this source measured by Herschel is about one third of the total flux density reported in the Early Least Compact Source Catalog. So this means that within the Planck beam, which is here represented by this circle, there is an additional contribution, which is maybe a factor of two higher than the flux of this source. Now, this may happen because this source happened by chance to be on top of a positive fluctuation in the CIB, but it may also be, and maybe it's even more likely, that this additional contribution is not there just by chance, but it is in some way related to this source. And the way by which it may be related is twofold at least. It may be that there is a strong overdensity of submillimeter forces sources just around this galaxy, or that this overdensity is in the foreground and it is maybe related to the structure that is responsible for the strong lensing. Now, this brings us to another issue that was pointed out already several years ago by Negrello et al., that Planck could well detect a protostructure at high redshift just because within the beam, Planck sums up the contribution of many, many galaxies that will be individually far below the Planck detection limit. I have schematized here two extreme situations. Maybe in some cases, Planck may just look towards a node in the cosmic web, and in this case, it can detect some real protocluster. But in other cases, it may look around the direction of of a larger scale structure, a filament. And in this case, the contribution that Planck can measure can be integrated, will be integrated over a much larger volume. Now, I've made I've copied here figures from the early paper by Negrello et al., just to remind that it was indeed predicted here. This is the estimated detection limit by Planck, about 300 millijanskis, which at 850 microns, which is really quite close to the 90% completeness quoted by Joaquin. And the simulation that we made at this time, represented by these points, were indicating that indeed some, not many, but these are going to be rare, but some sources of this kind could be detected by Planck. And in the same paper, it was pointed out that also the Herschel beam is big enough for having some blending effect, in the sense that some bright sources with fluxes of around 100 millijanskis or so could actually be blends of sources located in the cores of protoclusters. And one such example may have been found already. This is from the paper by Ives and et al. This is about 20 by 20 arcsecond map, Spitzer map, that is centered on a single Herschel spire source detected in the HATA survey. And Spitzer has resolved these sources into two bright objects of comparable luminosity, and both at the same redshift of 2.4. So, I just okay. I I tried here to give some indications of how we can try to guess about the nature of structures of this kind that the Planck may detect. And the exercise that I made here is to to consider what is the our best estimate of the halo mass associated to a protocluster which is strong enough for enough to have at least three galaxies detectable by Herschel. And the halo mass is estimated by this formula. And well, I come directly to this. This is telling us how many objects of this kind we may expect as a function of redshift within an area of 550 square degrees, roughly the area of the H-Atlas survey. And we see that this number dropped dramatically. And in fact, above redshift 2.5, we do not really, should not really expect any real cluster, real protocluster detected by Planck. If we see something above this redshift, then, in my opinion, we should think first, the first assumption we should take is that we are integrating along a filament. Planck is integrating along a filament. Well, I finish up by mentioning a couple of things about radio sources. Also, on this kind of sources, Planck has shed some new light, and in particular, well, I'm sorry, the figures are not very visible. Planck has demonstrated that a subset of blazars are already cataloged blazars. These are Planck data. Do have clear signs of being hosted by an actively star-forming galaxy. And this is at variance with the common belief that the hosts of blazars are passive galaxies. And combining this with Herschel data, it was possible, Lopez Caniego et al. Were able to determine the first ever counts of blazars at sublimeter wavelength, which have a lot of implications on the spectral energy distribution of these sources, which is also relevant for interpreting the contribution to the gamma ray background, but I have no time to get into that. So since I have out of time, I will only show my conclusions, and I won't even read them. I just leave it there for you to read if you want.
Okay, thank you.
We have time for Martin.
I would be suspicious of direct comparisons of fluxes between Planck at 850 microns and Herschel at 500 microns. The Herschel 500 micron field is tremendously overpopulated with all kinds of sources. You may have many dozens of Spitzer sources in there. And so an exact comparison of fluxes, even by order of magnitude or factors of two or three, I don't think would be reliable.
Oh, well, that's exactly true. I mean, the fact that the Planck beam is so large implies that we must be very careful in doing that. However, as you may remember, Joaquin González Nuevo has shown detailed comparison between Planck flux densities and Herschel flux densities at around 500 microns and 350 microns, and they generally match very well. In fact, there were some mutual help in that, in the sense that it was useful to assess which is the best kind of photometry from extracted from Planck maps, and it was also helpful to settle down some problems with photometry of large sources on the Herschel side. So, yeah, I agree with you that there is a problem. I also think that we have some idea on how big this problem is.
Any other questions? If not, then let's thank all the speakers for this session. And we resume at 2 o'clock sharp.